Welcome to Her Remarkable History. Remember, to support, please subscribe. The real cause of death of Margaret Tudor. Born to a family of six children, with only three of which surviving to adulthood, Margaret Tudor is the Tudor whose life was overshadowed by that of her younger brother, Henry VIII. Margaret was born to Elizabeth of York and Henry Tudor, making her the eldest surviving daughter of the newly created Tudor dynasty. Margaret was promised, after long negotiations, to James IV of Scotland in the Treaty of Perpetual Peace between England and Scotland on the 24th of January 1502. Margaret and James were married by proxy, and then in 1503 Margaret made the long journey north to Scotland. In Edinburgh at Holyrood Abbey, Margaret and James tied the knot officially on the 8th of August, and the occasion was even written about in the form of a poem by William Dunbar, The Thistle and the Rose. Margaret Tudor went from being a princess of England to a queen consort of Scotland. She and her husband James went on to have six children, one of which being the future King James V of Scotland, notably father to Mary, Queen of Scots. When Margaret initially arrived in Edinburgh, she would have been incredibly homesick, something that is portrayed in a letter she wrote to her father, Henry VII. Margaret, although still remaining an obscure member of the Tudor royalty, managed to tell her story in letters that have lasted for over half a millennia. In Margaret's letters to her father, she wrote, "God send me comfort that I and mine that be left here with me be well entreated. I wish I were with your grace now and many times more. I pray God I may find it well for my welfare hereafter. Our Lord have you in his keeping, written with the hand of your humble daughter, Margaret." Margaret's letters to her father, Henry VII, betray her as homesick and insecurities as she faced the reality of her new situation. Her response to her arrival in Scotland is hardly surprising. Her mother had died just 6 months previous, and in early July, she bid farewell to her father, knowing that she would probably never see him again. The journey north lasted over 3 weeks, and Margaret was exhausted. But Margaret's father was determined to demonstrate the success of his new dynasty through the success of his daughter. She was always on show, and Margaret was described as slim, red-headed, and always reported to have worn extravagant gowns. Margaret's husband James died in the Battle at Flodden in 1513, a battle between Scotland and England. England being a country led by Margaret's own brother at the time. After the death of James, Margaret acted as regent for Scotland, and it was also Margaret who managed to reconcile England and Scotland, for she had an upper hand being the sister of the enemy. "My party advisory continues in their malice and proceeds in their parliament, usurping the king's authority, as if I and my lords were of no reputation, reputing us as rebels. Wherefore I beseech that you would make haste with your army by sea and land. Brother, all of the welfare of me and my children rests in your hands." Then, in the year 1514, Margaret remarried, but this time it was in secret to a man called Archibald Douglas. He was the 6th Earl of Angus, and he was a powerful member of his house. But Margaret had made a mistake in remarrying, for the rules of James's will were clear. If Margaret remarried, she could no longer act as regent, and therefore the crown was passed to John Stuart, the 2nd Duke of Albany, and John also took custody of her sons, James and Alexander. Then, in the year 1515, Margaret and her husband fled over the border towards Harbottle Castle, and it was here that Margaret gave birth to a daughter, Lady Margaret Douglas, the future mother to Henry Stuart, Lord Darnley. It was just after the birth of her daughter that Margaret received the news that her son, Alexander, had died at Stirling Castle. And to double the wound, it was also at this time that Margaret's husband abandoned his wife to return to Scotland and make peace with Albany, and escape a charge of treason. But Margaret continued her journey further into England and made her way to London. In London, Margaret's brother Henry VIII had arranged lodgings for her at Scotland Yard in Whitehall. Margaret stayed in England in the company of her brother and sister, Mary, until the year 1517. The three had not been together for 13 years. But though Henry VIII treated Margaret well, he did not want her to stay. He believed that her place was in Scotland. Now, whilst Margaret was in London, a treaty was drawn up between Albany, Cardinal Wolsey and Henry VIII, and then Margaret returned to Scotland. But when she did return in the year 1517, she found her husband to be living with Lady Jane Stuart, and this prompted Margaret to seek a divorce and source the help of her brother. But surprisingly, at this time, Henry didn't believe in divorce and found himself unwilling to help, as he did not want to make an enemy out of his brother-in-law. But that didn't stop Margaret trying with all of her might to achieve her aim. She enlisted the help of Albany, who even spread rumours that he and Margaret were lovers, and then eventually in 1527, Pope Clement VII was finally convinced to grant the petition of divorce. This then opened up the path for Margaret to remarry again, but this time it was to a man called Henry Stuart, 1st Lord Methven, and this marriage took place on the 3rd of March 1528. But with all the anticipation and the excitement, it did not remain a happy marriage for very long. So once again, Margaret found herself with a man who could not remain faithful to his wife, and Margaret sought yet another divorce. But, as Margaret found with her second marriage, a divorce is not an easy thing to come by. And although she petitioned, she did not have the support of her son, who at the time was King James V. And so she was then eventually forced, but did, reconcile with Methven. On the 12th of June 1538, Margaret's son, James V, married Mary of Guise by proxy, and when Mary arrived in Scotland, she became good friends with her mother-in-law. Margaret died on the 18th of October 1541, and it was to be her great-grandson, King James VI of Scotland, that would inherit the Tudor crown upon the death of her niece, Elizabeth I, in 1603. On the 24th of March 1603, James VI became King James I, uniting Scotland and England and beginning a new dynasty, the House of Stuart. But what did Margaret actually die from? What was her cause of death? At the time of her death, Margaret was 51 years old, but it is believed that she died following something called a palsy. In layman's terms, this refers to an individual who is paralysed, and in the case of Margaret Tudor, it is believed to have been brought on by a stroke. Margaret, it seems, thought she was going to recover, however, as she did not make a will, but she did ask the king if he could give her possessions to her daughter, Margaret Douglas. After her death, Margaret was taken to Carthusian Charterhouse in Perth to be buried. But Margaret's afterlife would not be a peaceful one. During the Reformation, her tomb was desecrated and her skeleton was burned. The thoughts as to why is put down to possibly because she was both English and Catholic. Like her first husband, James, Margaret has no monument, and the Charterhouse in which she was initially buried now does not stand, as it was demolished during the said Reformation in 1559. Thank you for watching, and to support, please subscribe to Her Remarkable History. Thank you.